Okay, there's something wrong this morning. And what I mean by something wrong is you're all quietening down, and we still had a minute to go before the official time to start church. So I'm not quite sure what this is all about, but welcome to worship here at Goldston Methodist Church. I'm Kerry Wood, the pastor here, and we're so excited to be gathered together on this first Sunday of March. And isn't it beautiful weather? It's lovely. But you know what that means? Freezing at Easter. But as we go, we will do this. If you are visiting with us this morning, we're especially glad to have you with us, and we invite you to fill out one of those little visitor information cards that are available in the back. If you can leave that behind, that'll give me an opportunity to engage with you in this week and to be able to thank you for being a part of our worship here today. This is the beginning of a new month, which means we have a new mission for the Drop a Dollar, and that is on your yellow sheet here. We are going to be supporting the Childers family as they continue to deal with a variety of things as we remember and celebrate Kathleen, and we want to support Jay and all of their family. So that is our mission for the month for Drop a Dollar. As the kids come down for the kids' moments later on, do we have the bucket out here this morning? Is it there? All right, we got it. We're good to go. You can be a part of making that happen. Everyone has the opportunity to put your name on the prayer slip. This is the minimum requirement, to put your name on the prayer slip. Then once you put your name on it, you will tear it off. And if you have a specific prayer praise or a specific prayer request, you can add that to this. Then you will simply fold it in half, and during the hymn singing, we will pass baskets around. The first time you see the basket, put your slip in. Then they will swap sides, and the next time the basket comes around, take a slip out. And that then becomes the way for someone to be praying for you and for you to be praying for someone else. So we invite you to be a part of making that, because as we well know, we should be a church in prayer. Last thing that I want to talk about as far as an announcement is this little building over here, colloquially known as the candy store. We're going to be cleaning that space out next Saturday starting at 8 a.m. And everyone is welcome to come and help do the clean out. And as we are cleaning it out, if you discover that there is a treasure there that you would like to take home, you may. We're trying to clean out that space, and there's all kinds of stuff over there. So please come and be a part of helping to clean it up, clean it out, as we think about what that space might be used for down the road. Any other announcements? Anything that needs to be shared? Well, we do have a birthday in the house, so we do want to celebrate Jessica. Happy birthday today. Just by coincidence, her sister Ashlyn's birthday is today too. But Ashlyn's getting ready to fly for business, so she's not here this morning. But let's say happy birthday to Jessica. And Gray had a birthday. Was it Friday. So we can just say Jessica and Gray together. All right, we'll just run it all together.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Jessica and Gray. Happy birthday to you.
Amen. We're so happy to be able to celebrate with you. Now, my friends, I invite us to settle our hearts and minds to welcome the presence of the Holy Spirit in our midst as we listen to the bell ring. Carter is going to ring the Trinity chimes, and let us invite God to be a part of our worship together. stand as you're able and let us sing our call to worship, Into My Heart. Opening prayer. O God of life and light, shine in our lives today. Bless us with your presence here and speak to us the words that give life. Move in our midst today in a way that shows us our true condition apart from you. Soften our hearts to confession and repentance. And remind us of our purpose and calling to be your people. Amen. Our hymn of praise this morning is All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. If you want to use the music, it's number 154 in your hymnal, or the words will be on the screen.
Oh,
Now let us profess the faith that has been professed throughout the ages, all the way back to the beginnings of the Christian faith through the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. As the choir is coming down, I invite the children to come up as we get ready to celebrate kids' moments together. Let us sing Jesus Loves the Little Children.
Y'all like to receive presents?
I love to receive presents.
You do? I know, we all do, right? Everybody, so does anybody know, like, if I gave you this and I were like, okay, I have a present for you, but you have to give me $5. Does that make it a present? Right, you have to buy it. So a present or a gift is something that you get. There's no conditions. You don't owe any money. It's just because someone loves you, right? What's the best gift you've received, one of you? Easton, what's the best gift? What is it? Electrical scooter, okay. We're just going to do one. Just going to do one. So just one gift. I know you guys all have hundreds of gifts, right? Has everybody got a favorite gift?
Yeah, I got a trampoline.
A trampoline, okay, okay. And when you got those gifts, all you had to do was accept it, right? What happened? Oh, it hit the car. It's okay. You'll probably get another one, right? Okay, so today I'm going to tell you about the greatest gift you can ever receive. Anybody got any idea what that might be?
No.
Jesus, right? And God, right? Okay, so, and that gift is actually called eternal life. That sounds kind of deep. So eternal life means that if we accept Jesus and we love him and we follow him, that we can have eternal life in heaven. I mean, it doesn't get any better than that, right?
Yeah!
So the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Are you okay?
Yeah.
You good?
Uh-huh.
Are you in a hole?
Yeah, she is always not okay.
She's not okay? So, in this verse, whoever is you and me, so God has given us his Son to die on the cross for our sins to save us, right? Okay. But in this case, we didn't have to buy this gift, but we do know how much it costs. So how much does eternal life cost?
It costs $3,000.
No, does anybody know? What paid the price?
Zero.
What about God sent his Son Jesus, so it cost his only Son? So how much do you think God loves us to send his only Son? A ton, right? A whole ton. And how much does Jesus love us to give his life for us, right? That's a lot. Okay, so what's the greatest gift we've ever been given? Eternal life, right? Okay, so let's pray. All right. Can y'all ready to repeat? Thank you.
Thank you.
Father, for the greatest gift of all.
Father, for the greatest gift of all.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Who loved us so much.
Who loved us so much.
That he paid the price for our sins.
That he paid the price for our sins.
To give us the gift of eternal life.
To give us the gift of eternal life.
Amen.
Thank you.
God bless Courtney. As Deborah leaned over to me, she says, they're really wound up today, aren't they? So grateful for all of the children that we have. And one of our praises is we have more on the way.
Amen.
So we are happy to celebrate with Kathleen as Catherine, with the announcement that they are expecting with a little boy due in September. And I found out that she actually took the pregnancy test while she was at McDonald's. So I told her, I said, I don't care what you name him, he's always going to be, for me, Big Mac. So congratulations to you. Are there other praises that you all would like to lift up today? Good. We continue to love on you, Jay, and we're so glad to see you here with your sister sitting next to you, and continue to pray for God's blessings upon you and your life. Other joys. Yes, Leroy.
I'm thankful for all the prayers sent out to my son. He's doing well.
Good.
And he's so thankful.
Good. Tyler had an emergency appendectomy, and he's doing very well, so we praise God for that. As you all saw, Pat Harris had fallen and broke her hip, and I was able to go and spend some time with her at the hospital on Friday, and her spirits are really good given everything that she's been going through, and let's continue to keep her and her daughter Deborah in prayer. They're looking to be able to move her into some rehabilitation following the surgery, and they're hoping to get in over at Chatham Hospital's Rehab Center there in Siler City, so be in prayers that everything will fall into place that allow that to happen for them. And also just saw on Facebook that Vicky Bricky, her husband just had surgery, and so that's where she is this morning. So let's continue to keep the Bricky family in our prayers as well. Are there other concerns that you might have? Let's take these things that are, oh, no, I'm sorry, go ahead. Okay. So prayers for David, who has COVID, that it'll be mild and everything will progress with haste to heal him. Yes, indeed. Any others?
You remember our mother? Just learned that she's at the doctor or whatever right now. She had continued pain in her side.
Okay. Indeed, we will continue to keep your mom in prayer then. Let's take these things that are on our lips and that which is in our hearts. Let's take a few moments for silent prayer, and then I will pray, and then we will all pray the Lord's Prayer together. Gracious God, we come this morning to praise you, to celebrate who you are, and to also acknowledge who you are, and to allow you to work in us. God, we lift up each of these that we have lifted up for praises as well as for concerns. God, we live in a world that is in deep, deep turmoil. And so we pray for our world. We pray for our nation. We pray for elections and Super Tuesday that's coming up. And God, we pray that we as a nation will not get so caught up in labeling ourselves as Democrat or Republican or any other political party, but Lord, may we just be yours. I pray, God, that no matter what the outcome of election results may be, that those of us who are following faithfully to serve you will continue to do that. Give us, Lord, the urgency to show this world what love looks like, not from our perspective, but from yours. Not from our limitations, but through your unlimitedness, For God, we need your salvation. And we've come here as a result of wanting to be saved, wanting to be your people. And Father, if there's anyone here who is unsure of their salvation, may today be a day that you give them that assurance. Reassure us that we do indeed belong to you. You claim us and you have declared us to be your children, to be adopted, that we may call you Abba, Father. And it is so we now pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray to our Heavenly Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to stand as you are able and let us sing our hymn of preparation, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine. On the everlasting arms, what a blessedness, what a peace is mine. Leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning on Jesus, leaning on Jesus, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning on Jesus, leaning on Jesus, leaning on the everlasting. Jesus, lean on Jesus, safe and secure from all alarms. Lean on Jesus, lean on Jesus, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, have blessed peace with my Lord so near, leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Amen. You may be seated.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination.
Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen.
I'll be reading first from Jeremiah 17, verses 9 and 10. The heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it? I, the Lord, search the heart and examine the mind to reward each person according to their conduct, according to their deeds deserve. And then from Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is a gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Would you pray with me? The Spirit of the living God, fall fresh upon us, that as we hear you speaking into our hearts today, we will experience the wonders of repentance, forgiveness, and reconciliation. In your name we pray. Amen. So as you know, we have been going through this little booklet, the Catechism of Faith and Doctrine for the Global Methodist Church. This is the ninth Sunday that we've been asking these big questions and looking for bigger answers. But to help you understand that there is so much more than what I'm able to do on a Sunday morning, this is the ninth question, what is salvation today? But it reflects 53 of the questions in this booklet. So if you have not been using this little booklet to help you as you go through this series, I'm going to recommend that you grab a copy. I think we still have some out in the narthex. If you don't already have one, get one, because there's so much that is to be known, to be understood, to be claimed as the people of God in the Global Methodist denomination. So today we're dealing with this big question of what is salvation. Well, you got to kind of back up from the question of what is salvation to why do we need salvation? What even is salvation? What are we being saved from? And so this morning I thought, well, I will set this up perfectly by just using the news headlines from the morning on why we need and what are we needing to be saved from. So I whip up my iPad, I go out to Apple News, and I look up there, and lo and behold, the very first headline that I see is Whataburger is coming to North Carolina. Now, you may not understand this, but a guy who grew up in Texas, to hear that Whataburger is coming to North Carolina, man, that is not bad news. My goodness, this is the greatest news ever. If I'm going to eat fast food, it's not going to be McDonald's. It's going to be Whataburger. I mean, I still remember the slogan when I was growing up. Whataburger, Whataburger, just what a burger should be. Unbelievable, unbeatable, the bigger, better burger, Whataburger. I mean, I love Whataburger. And if I'm trying to use the news headlines to talk about how sad and sick our world is, that was not what I was expecting. But then I stopped and I reflected on that just a little bit. God save us from fast food. Because fast food, even if it is Whataburger, it's not good food, is it? It's good for the mouth. I mean, they know how to get our taste buds going and to give us that, this is so good feeling. But then you know what happens? You swallow. And you know what that food does? Once it's past the mouth, past the taste buds, and goes into the rest of your body and the digestive process, the body looks at this and goes, oh no, not this again. It spikes the blood insulin, and it causes fat storage in your cells, and it does all kinds of things. I mean, it's not good for you. And as I reflected on that truth, I realized this was the perfect headline to tell us why we need salvation. Because we don't know what we need to be saved from. We have been caught up in a net of confusion and false conviction about what is going to make everything good in this world today. And the world cannot offer us anything better than what God has already given. And so that's why we need salvation, is because we live in a world that is fallen. We live in a world that is broken. That's why Jeremiah describes that the heart is deceitful above all else. My friends, I'm going to tell you the bad news. You've got bad hearts. And I'm not talking about whether you've got high or low blood pressure. I'm not talking about whether you've got stents or other kinds of things going on with your physical heart. I'm talking about your soul heart is broken. Irreparably broken. The heart is deceitful above all things. Even when you think you've got it right, your heart is deceiving you. And I have to be honest, there have been a lot of times that I've let the deceit in my heart become the deceit in my mind and become the actions of deceit in my hands. Because I'm a sinner. My brokenness leads me to become a breaker for others. I'll give you just one example. Back when I was in college, I worked for a video and records store. This is back in the days when you would go to a store and you would rent what you wanted to watch on a cassette. It's called VHS, kids. And I worked for a company that had a whole bunch of videos available for rent, and we had the gamut of all kinds of videos, from the family-friendly to the not-so-safe for work. Well, one night after closing, as we were going around and we were cleaning things up, a person dared me, hey, get one of those movies and stick it in the player. Well, one of those movies was one of those things that was over in the reserved section, and you were supposed to be an adult to go into that section because of the content on those movies. Am I being clear without being clear? And so I took one of those movies, I don't remember what the name of it was, and I threw it in the machine, and sure enough, all over the video store, you start seeing these images of people engaged in unclothed activities. Can I say it that way? And it was funny. At least that's what my heart told me. But then God got in the way. Because you see, one of my fellow workers who I have been trying to be a Christian witness to, he came up to me and he said, Kerry, I'm really surprised that you put that kind of movie on the player. Aren't you a Christian? A silly thing, my heart's deception created the environment that my witness then became compromised. How could I claim to say that I live my life differently when I do something like that? I am sure that you can come up with a variety of stories of what you have done that you know you are broken and you have contributed to the brokenness of the world. Yes? I mean, I'm not a Baptist. I'm not going to say, can I get an amen? But that's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for agreement that you recognize that, yes, I'm broken. Yes, we're broken. We live in a broken world. We need salvation. Which brings us to this question in our catechism. Go ahead and show us that one. What is the natural state of humanity? Read the answer, friends. We believe humanity is fallen from righteousness and apart for the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ is destitute of holiness and inclined to evil. Now those are fancy highfalutin words that basically say this. On our own, we're in trouble. Yep, big trouble. Because we live in this fallen world. We live in an environment that cannot get things right, no matter how hard we might try. That's why it's apart from the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are destitute of holiness. There's no holiness in us. We are inclined to evil. We look for evil. We embrace evil without the power and the presence of God in our lives. That is why we need salvation, is because that is what we are in the state of our being. Which brings us to the next question. Can we free ourselves from the misery of this condition? No. In our own strength, without divine grace, we cannot do good works pleasing and acceptable to God. Do you know what the most common fallacy, even among regular church-going people, is? That at the end, God is going to look at you, and God is going to put up a scale, and everything that you've done good is going to go onto one side of the scale, and everything that you've done that is not good is going to go on the other side of the scale. And as long as the scale tips towards the more good than the not good, then you're in. People think this is how salvation works. I just have to be good enough for God to love me. That is the deceitful heart trying to tell us that we have to earn our way to Jesus. And that's not the way it is. It doesn't work that way. There is not going to be any kind of a scale whatsoever. You can be the person who gives away all of your wealth to help those who have no wealth, and that's not good enough. You can be the kind of person that is loving and kind in every kind of situation. You never get mad when you get cut off as you're getting onto the freeway. You never get upset when the grocery store clerk messes everything up as you are trying to get through the grocery line and you are in a rush to get home to fix dinner. It doesn't matter if you are the most kind and blessed person in everything that you try to do. If you're doing it on your own, it's not good by God's definition at all. We can't earn our way into God's good graces. In fact, to even say that is the deception, because God's grace is God's free gift given to you regardless of what you do or do not do. The simplest definition of grace that I've ever heard is getting what you don't deserve. None of us deserves God's love. There's no way we can earn our way into having God accept us. And that's the wild, crazy, wacky, wonderful thing about salvation, is that God already loves you in your brokenness, in your state of self-deception and deception in the world. Our problem is that too many of us, too much of the time, don't want God's love. Deborah and I attended a conference this week called the New Room Leaders Gathering, and there, one of the messages that I heard was given by a guy named John Tyson. And the title of his message was this: Wanting the Unwanted God. And I don't have time, obviously, to go through everything that John talked about, but one of the things that he said, that I knew this, but it had never really been given to me in this particular way, so that my brain went, oh, God is the most unwanted person ever. God has a history of rejection. Not him rejecting others, but of others rejecting God. I mean, think about this. God has created the beauty of the universe. And he has created the angelic beings to be a part of what he is doing in his glory. And Lucifer, the most beautiful of all the angels, he rejects God. He becomes the accuser, the ha-satan, that we describe today as Satan. Satan exists because he rejected God. He claimed that he could be God over God, and obviously was wrong. But it wasn't just Lucifer becoming Satan. He was able to pull other angels with him, and so the whole heavenly realms is dealing with the rejection of God. God creates the heavens and the earth. He places mankind on the earth. He gives us the image of God into our very core beings. And what happens? They reject God. One simple rule. Don't eat of that tree. They rejected God and said, I'm going to eat it. Because the deceiver came along, and what did he do? He convinced them, not just Eve, but Adam too, he convinced them that they could eat that fruit with impunity and be like God. You don't need God. You can be your own God. Rejection. Later on in the course of time, God calls a person that he is going to be the person to be a special people through whom all the world will be blessed. And Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, they go through periods of rejecting God. They become the people of Israel. And what do? They reject God over and over and over again. Finally, God says, I will give you my very self. And Jesus Christ comes into the world. And what does the world do with him? They reject him. And he willingly went through the rejection in order to keep the rejection from being mutual. And this, my friends, is what salvation is all about. Even when we reject God, God does not reject us. And yet today, we still don't want God. And he talked about four places where God seems to be unwelcome. Unwelcome in my own heart and life. Unwelcome in my home. Unwelcome in the church. And unwelcome in the community. Well, my friends, I don't want us to be in the business of not wanting God. There was a lot of discussion about the Asbury outpouring, that thing that happened a year ago on the campus of Asbury University. And one of the things that they talked about is those students desperately wanted God. And because they wanted God so much, guess what God did? He showed up in a way that none of those people had ever experienced the presence of God ever before. And my friends, this is what the salvation is all about, is being able to experience that presence of God in such a way that we are forever changed. We can't go back to that idea of the deceitful heart because we've been exposed to the true heart, the heart of Jesus Christ and the power of his love given to us. Which brings us to this last question for today. What is salvation? Read this answer. More than a promise of eternal life, but a present deliverance from sin, a restoration of the soul to its original purity, a recovery of the divine nature in righteousness and true holiness, in justice, mercy, and truth. My friends, the salvation that God offers us is to fix us, to heal us. In fact, salvation literally means a healing. Have any of you ever gone to the drugstore after getting a bug bite and you go and buy a salve to help relieve the itching? Did you know that the salve is the same root word that we get salvation? God's salvation gets rid of that itch of sin in our lives. What a wonderful gift this is. But there's a uniqueness to our Methodist understanding of what this salvation does to us that differentiates us a little bit from some of the other ways in which people have understood what salvation is all about. And to help you to understand what this difference looks like, I'm going to borrow from a very powerful North Carolina tradition. Basketball. This is March. March Madness is coming. So let's look at this basketball goal. Is there anything wrong with it? There's no rim. Now, let's say that we've got, I don't know, NC and NC State playing against each other. Do I have enough rivalry happening in the room? All right, so you've got the blue team, you've got the red team. They're throwing the baskets, or excuse me, they're throwing the ball around and they're shooting at this. How do they score? They can't. Without the hoop, throwing the basketball up there means nothing. My friends, salvation without the goal of salvation is just like this. We think we have something, which is the sweet by and by. But there's more to the Christian life and salvation for those of us who are Methodist than just waiting to get to heaven when we die. And so this is the next picture to look at instead. There is a goal. God has something in mind for you when you receive Jesus Christ. It's not just to get you into heaven when you die. It's to get heaven into you right now. Let me say that again. Salvation is not about getting into heaven when you die, but about getting heaven into you right now. In fact, this is the way that I describe it to my confirmation kids, and if they can get it, so can you. Freddie, put that up there. Salvation is being freed from sin for holiness. Will you all say that with me? Salvation is being freed from sin for holiness. My friends, when that basketball goes up into the air and hits that backboard, that is freeing you from sin. But do you know how the ball gets to the basket? It's not you throwing it. No, you can throw a basketball anywhere, but God is the one who directs it into the net. Being freed not from sin, but also for holiness. You see, when the holiness of God comes into us, He squeezes all the sinfulness out of us. And that is what salvation is. No more sin, no more shame, no more guilt, only love. The love of God in us, the love of God through us. And you're going to have to wait till next week to learn what it is to have love through you. Today, know this. You can be freed from sin for holiness through the love exhibited in Jesus Christ, given to you by the Spirit to the glory of God our Father. One God before time, now, and forever. Amen. Invite our ushers to come forward as we prepare to give of our tithes and our offerings. Please rise for the doxology. But God, we praise you for your great, great love, for the truth of your salvation and its burning into our souls. Lord, we ask that you would take these gifts today and use them for your kingdom purposes. Use us, the givers, to fulfill those purposes as we give ourselves, not just our money, to you. May, Lord, you work out our salvation as we cooperate with you in fear and in trembling. For your honor and glory. Amen. Our closing hymn is Beneath the Cross of Jesus. One of the other things that we talked about a lot at this conference this week was how we can experience God through something called lingering. And what I mean by that is the service may be about to be over, but if you have a sense that you need to linger still in the presence of God in this room, maybe God has been doing some work in you and you realize that, yes, Lord, I have been doing some rejection lately, and I'm sorry. I want to confess that. I want to move forward from that. Then linger. Maybe you've never experienced the idea of God's love so great to save you from your sin, and you want to experience that. Then linger. And I'm happy to be here to pray with you, to be a part of whatever God might be doing in your soul. But no matter what happens next, know this, you are loved. Amen.